So now what I have to say on the topic of hell will not be entirely contained in the following remarks, which are intended only as a springboard for discussion. No doubt many of you will not agree with many with a lot of the things I say in this talk. And much of what I have to say on the topic of hell will emerge only when I have heard your objections to these, let's call them these preliminary remarks. Okay, now, Christians, is there some water?
How?
Don't need it. Christians have taken three positions concerning the post-mortem condition of those human beings who are not saved in Christ. One, there is no such condition, for all human beings will be saved in Christ. That's universalism. Two, some human beings will not be saved in Christ, but either they will have no post-mortem existence at all, or it will be finite and in fact brief, probably long enough for them to be judged by God and condemned. That's annihilationism. And finally, some human beings will not be saved in Christ, and these unfortunate creatures will exist forever and will, throughout their endless post-mortem existence, be separated from God. That is, God will continue to hold them in existence and, in general, bear whatever causal ontological relations to them as are necessitated by the very idea of God and creature, but there will be no other connection between them and God. God will continue to love them, but they won't love God. They will in fact hate God and hate everything he has made. That is, they will hate reality. And therefore, they will hate themselves, although perhaps they'll hate themselves a little bit less than they hate other things, and so selfishness is still possible. Now, this third position is so close to being mere Christianity that it has no name. I'm going to call it damnationism. Annihilationists may protest that they do believe in damnation, but I ask them to indulge me because I need some work. I think it's clear that damnationism is the mind of the church. Now, by the church, I understand whatever it is that's referred to in the Nicene Creed as the one holy Catholic and apostolic church. It's controversial what the visible presence of the church referred to in the Creed in this world is. But I think that the views I ascribe to the church will be acceptable in any possible interpretation of that term. Now, the so-called Athanasian Creed is quite clear on the matter. It says, at whose coming, that is, at Christ's coming, all human beings shall rise again with their bodies and shall give account for their own works. And they that have done good shall go into everlasting life, and they that have done evil into everlasting fire. This is the Catholic faith, which, unless one believe truly and firmly, one cannot be saved. Or read Catholic, but it's just universal. That is, this is one universal church for everybody, and that's the opinion of the church. Now, I think the first question to be addressed, though, is not whether damnationism is true, but whether universalism is true. For annihilationism and damnationism are much closer to each other than either is to universalism. Here's a well-known question and answer from a doctrine called the Westminster Shorter Catechism. I can tell you about the history of it, but it's not important. The question and answer is, what is the chief end of man? And the answer is, man's chief end is to glorify God and to enjoy him forever. That's the end for which we were made. I think all Christians accept this. And according to both annihilationism and damnationism, some human beings will lose the end for which they were made. And that's the most terrible conceivable fate for a human being. Abandoned hope, all ye who enter here, and you have lost the end for which you were made, there are two ways of saying the same thing. According to universalism, however, no human being will suffer this terrible fate. We might say that annihilationism and damnationism are both species of perditism, a word I formed from the Latin word for the verb to lose. I looked it up on Google to see if anybody used it for anything else. I found that it's the name of a Chinese heavy metal band. asked about, well, the negative aspects of our postmodern existence is whether to accept universalism or periodism. If periodism is decided upon, then one can go on to debate the relative merits of annihilationism and damnationism. It's not my purpose to enter into a battle of proof texts as regards universalism and periodism. There are convinced universalists who are familiar with every text that has ever been cited in this connection. For instance, my friend Marilyn Adams, a great scholar of medieval philosophy, priest of the Episcopal Church, is a convinced universalist, and she knows, I'll bet there is no one in this room who knows their Bible better than Marilyn Adams. Certainly not I. Now, whether these convinced and biblically literate universalists are rational or irrational, whether they're insightful interpreters or perverse misinterpreters of Scripture, no argument based on Scripture is going to convince them. After all, each of them is perfectly familiar with every scriptural argument concerning the universality of salvation. I will say only two things about universalism. It has not been rejected. It has been rejected by the church at most times and in most places. If not, semper ubi quae omnibus, that is, always everywhere and by everyone. At any rate, very nearly so. And secondly, although individual universalists often retain robust Christian faith, Marilyn, for example, or my friend Alvin Plantinga, there is a certain amount of evidence for the hypothesis that this is not the case with denominations. So there used to be a denomination called Universalism. They believed everything other Christians did, except they adopted Universalism. And there was a denomination called Unitarianism. They believed everything other Christians did, except they rejected the. Well, it turns out, apparently, it's hard to retain anything if you accept reject either of those beliefs, because they eventually became indistinguishable denominations, merged into the Universalist Unitarian Association, and you don't have to believe anything in particular for going to that. I don't know if that's an inevitable consequence of the denominations rejecting periodism, but it's kind of a worrying possibility. But now let's turn to the relative merits of annihilationism and damnationism. Again, I don't want to enter into a debate about proof texts. I have now noticed that in their arguments about these texts and the issues they raise, annihilationists make frequent use of two premises, both of which I reject. One is that the only way for a human being to exist forever is that for that human being to have inherited what the New Testament calls eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. Zoe Ionia, John 3:16. Now, closely connected with their use of this premise, being that that eternal life, that's the only way for a human being to exist forever. Connected with their use of this premise is their emphasis on the frequent biblical opposition, and it's illustrated by that very verse from John, between those who will obtain eternal life and those who will perish or be destroyed. And do not fear those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul, rather fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Matthew 10:28. They shall suffer the punishment of eternal destruction and exclusion from the presence of the Lord and the glory of his body. 2 Thessalonians. That's one of the premises that I'm going to reject, is that the only way for human beings to exist forever is to be have what Christians call eternal life. The other thing I'm going to reject is that damnationism entails that the damned are subject to everlasting, continuous, unendurable torment. Now, I'll try to explain why I reject both these premises. Now, Christians believe that the life that we shall be raised into in the general resurrection Let's call that kind of life Zoe. Is not the old life that we lost when we died, the Adamic life, or Theos. Well, you can distinguish between resurrection and resuscitation. So the widow's son in 1 Kings 17, the other widow's son in Luke 7, Lazarus, and in the Matthew version of the story, Jairus' daughter, were resuscitated, not resurrected. The Theos that was lost and was restored to them. I think that the best sense that can be made of the statement in the Athanasian Creed, that human beings shall rise again with their bodies, must recognize this distinction. If, like the Creed calls, those who have done evil rise with their bodies, those bodies, of course, must be alive. But surely we don't want to say that the damned are alive with the new life, Zoe, the resurrection life, compared for those who have done good. I think we must say that they have been merely resuscitated. It is allowed, or perhaps it would be more accurate to say forced, to return to Bios. Well, remember that frequent biblical, well, this occurs twice in the Old Testament, they have made a covenant with death. This means the covenant with death is, hey, death, I'll allow you, in return for being able to behave any way I like in this life, I accept eternal extinction afterwards. In other words, you escape from any divine retribution by moving into eternal extinction. What this resuscitation shows is that death does not have the power to keep its sight of the bargain. But if God can restore the bios of a long dead human being, He can also, if He so wills, maintain that human being and be us forever. So we must, I think, we must distinguish between eternal Zoe and mere everlasting be us. It's therefore possible for a human being to exist forever without inheriting the eternal life or promise of Christ. Existence that never ends is, for a human being, simply the abstract common element of eternal Zoe and everlasting be us. And the latter is not something to be desired, although it's the existence of facilities for animating or for maintaining frozen corpses demonstrates it is certain is desired. As Gandalf said to Frodo, a mortal Frodo who keeps one of the great rings does not die, but he does not grow or obtain more life. He merely continues until at last every minute is a weariness. I think that's a good description of the way the damned persists through time. To coin another word, it's a description of immorbidity rather than immortality. I don't mean to imply that immorbidity is what damnation is or consists of. For all I know, one could be immorbid, that is, live without biologically aging or becoming ill in this kind of life we have now for many millennia without becoming separated from God. The condition of damned, I've already said something about it. Hatred of God and everything He's made, and I'll have more to say about it later. Well, what about perishing and destruction? As to perishing, one must note that the rhetoric of the New Testament is not ours. Our Lord said, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters, yes, and even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. Luke 14:26. Now, one must suppose this means something like, and is not willing to sacrifice his relations with his father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters and to give up his own life in order to follow me. Why then didn't Jesus say that, or words to that effect? Because the past is a foreign country. They do things differently. And of course, even more than most other first century Jews, Jesus was fond of paradox and hyperbole. He delighted in saying things that he knew would seem bizarre or even mad to his audience as things designed so to astonish his hearers that for a moment, at least, the power of the habitual ways of thinking would be broken. Suppose we've been made for eternal life. Suppose it's our end. But suppose that some of us will never really receive the life they were made for. Is they will perish? Not a rhetorically effective description of that loss. And if you don't think so, might you at least be willing to say that it would have been rhetorically effective if it had been addressed to a first century. destruction of a thing, a city or a temple, for example, may leave behind a ruin. Now, perhaps what that is what the damned are, ruins of human beings. Note, by the way, that in the passage from 2 Thessalonians, Paul says not only that the damned shall suffer the punishment of eternal destruction, he also says that they shall suffer the punishment of eternal exclusion from the presence of the Lord and the glory of his might. That description of the second punishment, if it doesn't logically entail that the damned will exist, really strongly suggests it. If Paul believed that the damned would be annihilated, his choice of words was rather odd. But of course, I have to confess that C.S. Lewis spoke for me when he said, I cannot be the only reader who has wondered why God, having given Paul so many gifts, withheld from him that lucidity and order of explanation. Now the other premise of the annihilation, annihilationist, I wish to dispute, the thesis that damnation implies that the condition of the damned is one of everlasting, continuous, unendurable physical torment. Unendurable in the sense that the damned, any of the damned who literally and hesitating to opt for annihilation if it were offered. There's a disquieting fantasy story by Abram Davidson called Summerland. In this story, the first person narrator is dragged to a seance by his mother, who's a fervent believer in spiritualism and medium, whereas the narrator, for his part, thinks it's all a rap and a particularly nonsensical one. Well, this medium is a Mrs. Porteous, and she's attempting to reach the departed spirit of a man only a few days dead called Charlie King. And the seance is being conducted at the behest of Charlie King's widow, Mary. Now, according to Mrs. Porteous's brand of spiritualism, Charlie is now in Summerland, the post-mortem paradise, which is the place at which the departed depart to. Now, the late Charlie King was a real piece of work. He was a slumlord of the very worst description, a man who basked in self-approval, who suffered not the least pang of compunction for the misery that the squalid and unsafe housing he provided visited on the wretches who had to live in it. A fat and sleek man who slept well at nights. Well, Mrs. Porteous does her stuff while those present at the seance sit in a circle and hold hands in a funky little parlor well supplied with candles and incense. She rolls her eyes and she mutters and she does all the other things that mediums attempting to contact the departed do. And Charlie King screamed. It was Mrs. Porteous's mouth that it came from. It was her chest that heaved, but it was Charlie King's voice. Don't you think I know that voice? He screamed, the fire, oh Mary, how it burns! I knew Charlie King, I knew his voice. Now certainly, Charlie King screaming in the fire fits one picture of the condition of the damned, a picture that many people had. And it would be idle to pretend that this picture had a scriptural basis. Among scores of verses we could cite, Matthew 25:41, then he will say to those at his left hand, depart from me, you cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. Revelation 20:15, and if anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire. Revelation 14:11, and the smoke of their torment goes up forever and ever, and they have no rest day and night. But it's not the only picture. Contrary to popular opinion, it's not the picture that you find in Dante. It's not even the picture that you find in Dante of the lower circles, at least for the most part. As Eleanor Conklin pointed out, the damned souls that Dante and Virgil encounter in the course of their journey through hell are capable of calm, rational, and lucid conversation, some of Charlie King writhing in the flames when they're to be capable. It's also not the only way damnation is pictured in Scripture. There are, in fact, three ways damnation is pictured in the New Testament, or three that I've not already discussed, because I suppose we should count perishing or being destroyed as one of the ways. There is first damnation pictured in terms of physical suffering, deserved physical suffering. There is secondly damnation pictured in terms of the disposal of refuse. The dam will be like the tares when the wheat is harvested, the chaff after the wheat's been ground. And of course, the biblical and popular picture hell draws on both us. It says fire is both very painful, and what do you do with refuse? What do you do with this throw in fire? And thirdly, there is damnation pictured in terms of loss, deprivation, and exclusion, the separation from God. This last is seen in the outer darkness parables in Matthew, the centurion's faith, the talents, the wedding feast, and we might add the wise and the foolish virgins, although the phrase outer darkness doesn't occur in that parable. We might also cite the passage from 2 Thessalonians, also quoted the exclusion from God, the glory of God's presence and might. And then there's Matthew 7:23. And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me. Now what I want to do in the remainder of this remarks is to present an imaginative picture of hell. Now just so story, if you like, that the comic incorporates these three elements. Like many Christians who are trying to think seriously about hell, I've been strongly influenced by C.S. Lewis's The Great Divorce. The title, in the event that you don't know the book, is an allusion to Blake's The Marriage of Heaven and Hell. And I see, by the way, that there will be a dramatic presentation of The Great Divorce here at Azusa Pacific in your theater in February. So I encourage everybody to go to it. I suppose it's best to admit right up from the enormous influence that book has had on the way I think about hell. If you know the book, the influence will be evident to you. One part of my imaginative picture, the first chapter of my Just So story, will be a fictional representation of judgment and damnation. Now, I suppose most people would concede that if there's a hell, and if anyone deserves to be in it, Hitler deserves to be in it. So let's make Hitler, if not the hero, then the protagonist of our story. Now, of course, you and I are right about Hitler. If we didn't think our actual opinion of Hitler was correct, we'd adopt some other opinion. We're right about the facts of his biography, not that we know them, most of us know them in the way of historian in modern European history would know them, but, and we're right in our moral judgments about him. And of course, Hitler was wrong about himself, about as wrong about himself as it's possible for anyone to be. And in the moment you see why I bother to mention these obvious facts. But don't suppose I mean by this choice of a protagonist to imply that one has to be as bad as Hitler to be in danger of losing the end for which one was made. Remember that the New Testament word usually translated as sin, martia, literally means missing the mark. And remember the proverb, a miss is as bad as a mile. All right, Hitler commits suicide in his bunker beneath the ruins of Berlin. At some point, he faces judgment. Perhaps at the moment of his death, perhaps shortly after his death as a disembodied soul, perhaps thousands of years later on the day of the general resurrection. It doesn't matter, at least for our present purposes, when he faces judgment. What matters for our purposes is the judgment he faces. What form does it take? What is it like to fall into the hands of the living God and be judged by him? Here's my tale. Hitler stands before Christ, and he finds that he must look into his eyes. In those eyes, he sees a reflection of himself, a reflection that shows him as he really is. He doesn't want to look at the reflection, but he finds that he must. Of course, the reflection shows him to be what you and I think he is, since we're right about it. What he sees is at once a monster and a pathetic fool. What he sees, moreover, is a self-deceiver, whose picture of the world in his own place and it is a fantasy constructed by himself carefully over the course of many years. He wants to shout it's a filthy lie, but at that moment the Holy Spirit seizes him, and in his power, Hitler sees that the filthy lie is the simple truth, God's own truth. Then the Holy Spirit releases him. It is now in his power to reject what he has been shown. He's been forced to look at something. He's had his face rubbed in it, and then the force that made him look at it withdraws, and it exists, the picture exists only in his memory. He's once more able to call it a lie. He knows, he's not allowed not to know, that eternal joy awaits him eventually. He rejects what he's been shown, if he accepts what he's been shown. If he doesn't accept it, then eternal joy, he will lose that. Eternal joy will be denied to him not so much as a punishment, but simply because joy of any kind is impossible for such a creature as he is now. Or I suppose you could say it's just a punishment, for punishment is a flexible word. You can look at the sufferings that a sinner endures as punishments if they're the natural and inevitable consequences of his sins, I suppose. So what choice will Hitler make? Well, he's pulled in two directions. Pulling in one direction is the testimony of the Holy Spirit, which on some level he knows is true. For what that's worth, consider a submissive and insecure woman who on some level knows that her husband is sexually abusing their daughter. Sadly, it doesn't follow that she will do anything about it. It doesn't even follow that she will not insist in the face of irrefutable evidence that her husband would never do such a thing. But pulling in the other direction is this fact. If Hitler accepts what Christ in the Spirit has shown him about himself, he must see himself as we, you and I, see him. He must see himself as both a monstrous tyrant, an excellent candidate for the office of worst man who ever lived, and as a pathetic little man whose whole life is founded on lies. He must discard the fantastic self-portrait that he spent the last four decades or so painting, his greatest work as an artist, and which is the principal furnishing of his mind. Now, if you know anything about my work as a philosopher, you'll know that I have nothing against free will. Nonetheless, I think it immensely improbable that at this point Hitler does not have it. I suspect that although he is able to reject what he has been shown, he's not able to accept it. But even not, he can be forced to accept it, but he's not able voluntarily to accept it. And even if he is able to accept it, I think it immensely probable that he will reject it. They will attempt to justify this choice by making a speech. As after all, man and his father made speeches. A speech that could be summarized in these words that would probably go on for hours and hours. It's a filthy lie. It's a filthy Jewish lie. I know you, Jew. I see now that the whole universe is run by Jews. Well, I won't have any part of it. A true hero like myself will do the noble thing, even if it means defying the entire universe. I choose the heroic and noble thing. I deny your authority to judge me. I defy you. I defy the whole filthy Jewish universe you have made. I will depart from you. And then he strides off into the darkness, out of the presence of God, or into a condition that is close to being outside God's presence as it's ontologically possible for a creature of condition to be. Note that in making the speech, Hitler has called the Holy Spirit a liar. This may be the blasphemy against the Holy Spirit that has no forgiveness. Might not God give him a second chance? Well, perhaps if Hitler were able to accept God's judgment, he would be given a second chance. Suppose he's not able to accept it. Suppose that in the course of his life, by a long series of free choices, he had rendered himself unable to accept any judgment of himself that he could be guilty, what I call his fantastic self-worker. Then any second chance would be a travesty, for God knows that the outcome would be the same. Well, the interlocutor, the objector, says, if Hitler was not able to accept the judgment of Christ in the Spirit, why did they bother to subject him to such a ceremony? What purpose did it serve? If a second chance would be the travesty, where was the first chance? Not equally a travesty. Well, if I so express myself, the forms must be observed. In the military services, there's a convention that if an armed mutiny occurs, then before it's suppressed by force, the senior officer present must, if possible, explicitly issue an order along the following lines. This is a direct order. Lay down your arms and subject and surrender yourselves to legitimate authority. And such an order is to be issued even if it is perfectly clear to the issuing authority that it will not be obeyed. The purpose of the convention is easy to see. If it is explicitly disobeyed, then what was a de facto UB is now a de jure. So it is with God and judgment. It is fitting that the final irrevocable act of disobedience be actual, and not really something that God knows would have happened if there had been a formal judgment. The objector says, you picture Hitler as in effect casting himself into hell. But doesn't the scripture say that it's God who casts the unrepentant sinner into hell? Luke 12:4-5 says, do not fear those who kill the body, but after that have no more that they can do. Fear him who after he has killed has the power to cast him into hell. I doubt, though, whether the distinction between Hitler's casting himself into hell and God's casting himself into hell has any substance. Everything that happens in the creative order, including the voluntary acts of rational creatures, happens only with God as its concurrent cause. To adopt a phrase the philosopher Peter Teach once used, it's only by God's favor that Hitler's wits hold together from one end of his blasphemous rant to the other. But now, here comes this question. Why does God not simply annihilate Hitler rather than allowing him to insist in eternal presence? Well, perhaps. Again, perhaps Hitler would prefer not to be annihilated. Perhaps annihilation is not what he would choose if he were given the choice. Granted, someone in Charlie King's situation would certainly elect annihilation. But perhaps Hitler does not find himself in unendurable physical pain when he is stalked off into the outer darkness. Perhaps his own choice would be to continue to exist so that he can continue to nurse his grievances against God and the whole reality that God has made, so that he continue to rage against the unfairness of finding himself in a universe governed by a Jewish God, so that he can continue to be Hitler. If so, he would be the dark mirror image of Galadriel in The Lord of the Rings. I pass the test, I will ordain Galadriel. I pass the test, he says to himself as he removes himself from the presence of God. I will ordain Adol. And perhaps God respects that preference. To adapt some words of Lewis's, those who will not say to God, thy will be done, will find God saying to them, thy will be done. And what will be the condition in which Hitler finds himself when he casts himself, or God casts him, as you prefer, into hell? Well, one thing we might imagine is that it will resemble the condition of Napoleon, as it's represented in the Great Divorce. Now, according to the story Lewis tells, two damned souls are possessed of enough intellectual curiosity to search out Napoleon. What's a necessary plot device, but unrealistic. No damned soul cares a damn about any of the others. Those who have lost the intellectual good, as Dante puts it, can hardly be moved to action by intellectual curiosity. Did they see Napoleon? The first person narrator asks. Yes, he's told them. Napoleon had built himself a huge house in the Empire style. You could do that sort of thing in hell. And the two curious souls peeked in through one of the windows and saw him. What was he doing? Walking up and down, all the time, left, right, never stopping for a moment. The two chaps watched him for about a year, and he never rested, and muttering to himself all the time, it was Sewell's fault. It was Nate's fault. It was Josephine's fault. It was the fault of the Russians. It was the fault of the English. Like that, all the time. Never stopped for a moment. A little fat man, and he looked kind of tired, but he didn't seem to be able to stop him. So there's one kind of model for Hitler in hell. It was Goering's fault. It was Himmler's fault. It was Goebbels' fault. It was Dönitz' fault. It was the fault of my generals. It was the fault of the Bolsheviks. It was the fault of the Jews. It was the fault of the British. Now, this model, it seems to be accommodates the new picture of the damned as being cast or casting themselves into the outer darkness, and it accommodates the picture of the damned as refuse. But what about pain? What about physical suffering? Are we to suppose that although there's physical suffering and despair on this earth in this present life, there will be none in hell? Although I think it plausible to suppose that the realistic picture of Napoleon in hell is making allowance for literary license, an accurate description of the interior condition of the mind of a creature separated not only from God, but from all his other creatures. I think it may be only vacuously right, for I see no reason to suppose that any of the damned will be separated from all the other damned creatures. It's plausible to suppose that many, even most of the damned, would prefer to be alone, absolutely alone. That would seem to be a very natural attitude for someone to take if that person hates everyone. Such a person would be something would be nowhere near himself if that were only possible. But I'm afraid, however, that the damned will, like it or not, find themselves in one another's company. After all, you don't get what you like in hell all that frequently. If it's not really true to say that hell is other people, it may be true to say that the physical sufferings of the people in hell are inflicted on by other people, or more generally by other rational creatures. We must remember that the plain sense of scripture is that human beings are not the only rational creatures that human beings will encounter in hell. When a damned soul separates itself from God, it separates itself from all good things other than those essential to what Roman Catholic philosophers used to call the ontological good. That is, existence itself, causal powers, life of a sort. And that includes all natural affections, human solidarity, loyalty, all sense of right and wrong, other than wrong is done to oneself. And those things are still to be found, at least to some minimal degree, among the worst human beings in this life. Hitler, no doubt, felt affection for Eva Braun and for his dog, Blondie. The worst people often have friends or at least allies. There is honor among thieves. There's the pirate's code, even though it's more like what you call guidelines than actual rules. None of these things can be cast into hell. There's no place. There's no place for them there. I'll leave it to you to imagine what such people, people filled with hatred and rage and despair, might do to one another. And in an environment where death is impossible, that nerve endings and functioning prefrontal cortices exist. There is no hope in hell, as a reliable source has informed us, but there may be false hope. A bad man in hell can, for example, falsely hope to get satisfaction from torturing someone who he supposes has crossed him or disrespected him, or even who just happens to be handy. I can imagine somebody setting himself up as a sort of world. There wouldn't be any solidarity in hell, but maybe some people might man together and underachieve for an efficiency, or because they think they see some disadvantage in them. And I can imagine such a warlord ordering certain persons he hates a little more than he hates everyone else to be roasted over a slow fire for a couple of decades, or is roasting people for no reason, just for the hell of it, as they say. But if he hopes to get some sort of satisfaction from this, he's hoping to be frustrated, which will enrage him even further. And no doubt one day, forever is a long time, no doubt one day the tables will be turned and he'll be the one being roasted. Revenge will be a powerful motive in hell, but revenge will not be sweet. Nothing will be sweet. People will torture and hate one another and take revenge because what else is there? What else is there? Jesus tells us that the meek are blessed, for they will inherit the earth. I once heard a priest define the meek as those who don't throw their weight around. Hell will be entirely populated with people who want to do nothing but throw their weight around. Everyone else will be busy inheriting the earth. But sadly, of course, everything about hell is sad. A lot of them, at least in any given moment, won't be in a position to throw their weight around. They'll be the recipients of the attention of those of the unbeat who are more powerful than they. In our present life, God often protects the weak from the strong, from those of the strong who like to throw their weight around at us. In this life, the weak can pray for deliverance, but there will be no such protection for the weak in hell. The weak in hell have forfeited any possibility of divine protection. In hell, the strong have a free hand, and they need not fear divine retribution, for they've already received all the divine retribution they're ever going to get. And those weak have no complaint against the strong. The strong are only doing what they, the weak, would do if the tables were turned. And perhaps one day they will be turned. And they will be in a position to reap their joyless vengeance on the former strong. In fact, inevitably, I guess, just given that things are going to go on forever. Here's an easy little scrap from a fantasy novel by Rogers the Last. A horned and tufted purple thing went racing along the ridge to my right, pursued by a hairless orange-skinned creature with long claws and a forked tail. Both were wailing bitten geese. It was just one damned thing after another. Precisely. In the matter of physical pain, at least, hell is just one damned thing after another. The pain occurs when the former catches the latter. Well, what about the virtuous pagans? Dante put them in a circle where there was no physical pain. Well, what the just-so story should say about the virtuous pagans is a matter of opinion. I'm inclined to think that all truly virtuous pagans are unbelievers of any kind would be saved. But I don't mean to imply that anyone in this present darkness, pagan or Christian or modern unbeliever, is virtuous enough to deserve eternal life. Salvation comes only through Christ, but it may come at the last possible moment, that is on the day of judgment. In terms of my picture, it will all come down to what people being judged, whether they were Christians in this earthly life or members of some remote tribe who had never heard the name of Jesus, how they will respond when they're shown themselves as they really are. Will they accept the testimony of Christ in the Spirit, or will they reject it? I expect that if I were in a position to ask Jesus what was to be the eternal fate of, say, the members of some tribe in the beginning who had never heard of the gospel, he would say to me, "What is that to thee, follow them?" I'm going to pause. I'll mention two topics I haven't discussed, but I'd be happy to talk about during the Q&A. One, whether my fanciful picture of God is consistent with the numerous eternal fire verses in the Gospels and Revelation. And on the other topic is the following words from the inscription chiseled above the gate of hell in Canto 3 of Inferno. I was created by the light divine, the highest wisdom.
Thank you for your presentation. I appreciate it big time. So you talked about hell, but what about Satan in the conception that you kind of proposed?
This is for the I like the walk.
Okay.
So Elizabeth, we're recording. So I said there's one great thing that it's likely that human beings. The plain sense of scripture is that it's not just other damned human beings that human beings are going to encounter in hell. Yeah, there will be. I guess I want to make the point that if there's going to be physical pain in hell, the actions of human beings could fully account for it. But suppose that there's these other horrible, powerful beings trapped there. That is certainly going to make it even worse, because they are just as frustrated, just as enraged, just as presumably vastly more horrible than we. So, is that directed at the kind of question about Satan you wanted to ask, or did you have something else?
No, that's perfect. Thank you. Yeah.
Just so I can understand a little bit what happens at judgment, Hitler sees his whole life reflected back at him. He still has a full rational capability to make a choice or to accept what he sees or to reject it, is that grounded in, like you say, he's lost free will at that point, so I'm trying to understand, is this a habituation, like is there some sort of an intellectual virtue or vice, like has he cultivated a certain sort of vice over his lifetime that makes him incapable of accepting the truth that he sees? Or is there something that after death or at the time of judgment, his rational, like his capability of reasoning properly, he's just so cut himself off from certain sort of evidence that he's incapable of, like he could not, like he actually has that free will removed from him, or is this something he's done to himself? I'm just trying to understand that a little more clearly.
Well, either he has free will or he doesn't. Free will would mean he's able to, in this sense, he's able to accept what he's been shown and he's able to reject it. I said I doubted he had free will, meaning I doubted he was able to accept it. I just have to ask, you know, Hitler thought of himself as the wonder of the ages, you know, and supposed there's this picture of him that says he's the very opposite. He's not a hero, he's a villain. He's not a great man, he's pathetic. What will it take to convince him of that when he spent 40 years reinforcing the belief that he's something else? There are, I think, there are plenty of things that I wouldn't believe no matter what somebody said. I mean, if somebody from the Man Boy Love Association tells me that children really enjoy the sexual attentions of adults, I don't think I'm physically capable of believing that. That you might say that that's a matter of intellectual virtue, but it's a matter of training, not because not everybody believes that. Some people believe other things. Well, Hitler is trained himself. To believe, I think he's trained himself, and certainly if he lacks free will in this matter, it's because of his own actions. As we train ourselves to become certain sorts of persons, as we get older, our free will diminishes. As we settle ourselves into our characters, we form our character, things that might have gone another way are no longer open to us. I think he's probably will have closed off every possible. He will have trained himself out of the ability to accept any other picture than himself. But that we don't, doesn't even make any difference if this is true of the actual historical figure Adolf Hitler. Let's say it's true of the man in the story, because after all, this is just a Justovian story. I feel a little bit uneasy. I feel a little spiritual danger, even in talking about Hitler, you know, because we're told, judge not, that you be not judged. I think probably less danger doing that with Hitler, and also it seems to me more probable that someone like Hitler actually is in this position where he's not able to accept any other picture than the one he's shown. But I did mean primarily that he had no free will, though I did say that if he did have it, I still thought it was very probable that that's not what he would do.
So, kind of what I'm getting from your kind of offered conception of how is this Hitler, in this sense, he's done so many egregious things that he's not able to come to terms with himself in the presence of God. In the Bible, we have the example of Saul, who, I guess in this life, he has also done these egregious acts, and then he encounters the presence of the Lord, and then he's saved, and we have the whole, you know, we have the rest of Acts as the story plays out. It would seem that his actions also, he's also self-deceived, but he doesn't, when he encounters the presence of God, he doesn't have any sort of, it's not by his own self-awareness or own ability to acknowledge his poor deeds that brings him into the Lord's presence and salvation. It's that the story seems told that God comes upon him and presents himself versus like Saul's own capacity. So I wonder, like in the same thing with this kind of hell account, if that applies. Does it kind of make sense where, am I making sense where I'm going or the direction that I'm headed?
Well, I'm not sure. Here's, what do you think of in Luke, the parable of the rich man and Lazarus, the beggar? In the end, it's suggested that by sheer power, God might save the rich man's brother, who's still alive and sitting away. Just let me, by a miracle, go to him and warn him. And God tells him, if they will not listen to Moses and the prophets, neither will they believe if one is raised from the dead. That is, now, the truth, this isn't God's making himself present the way maybe he did to Job in the end. It is by a sheer display of power, or try to convince the person his life is just a little white crowd. But the fictional, let's call him the fictional Hitler that I created in the story, has spent years, decades and decades and decades of building up a fantastic web of illusion in his own mind. Now he's being asked to tear that all apart, all down, tear it apart, start over like a little child. And he's not, in the story, he's not willing to do that anymore. I would raise the question, why bother with this ceremony if he's not willing, if God knows he won't do that? I don't even know, though, if I'm addressing the question that you are asking.
I guess it's not maybe a matter of choice, but it seems that Saul encounters the presence of God, and the choice is very evident, of course. Well, like, he encounters Jesus, and then he proceeds to live out a Christian life. And so it's not that he encounters, like, his own terrible acts, and he's not able to face them. There's no, we don't see any account of that.
Well,
it's just this God encounter, and then
so let's say Saul, that he was not a bad self-deceived man like Hitler. He was wrong about the nature of the Christian movement. Doesn't Gamaliel says to the Sanhedrin at some point, if it's not from God, it will destroy itself. If it's from God, you can't destroy it. Just that suddenly Saul becomes convinced that what he thought were people that were enemies of God are actually God is on their side. He just changes his mind about what matters in the world. And this is not done, I think, for Saul's salvation. This is done as one of the great acts in salvation history. This is putting the church, the young church, on a certain course. Saul is being used as an instrument by Cyrus. God needs him for a certain purpose, and by his power, he shows him that he was wrong. But Saul is able to see that he was wrong. I think that, and it's not wrong about himself. He was wrong. This isn't the picture himself is wrong, it's that his picture of the Christian movement was wrong. I think it's a different kind of case.
Hey, I have a quick question. According to this picture of hell, and this picture of judgment, rather, would it make sense to say that anyone who would have accepted Christ had they heard a decent testimony end up looking in the face of God and being saved post-mortem?
Well, of course, this raises... Oh.
Thank you.
suppose
I have free will. And yesterday, I might have been faced with a difficult choice. Somebody was coming to me with the intention of bribing me to do something wrong, or rather offering me a bribe, which I would freely accept or not. But then he got cold feet or decided there was a better plan or something, and then I was never, the offer was never made to me. Do you think there's such a thing as what I would have done? I think if it really would have been a free choice, of course, I would be delighted to think that it wouldn't be a free choice if somebody offered me a bribe, that I wouldn't have any choice but not to accept it. But, I mean, there are some people in every rank for whom accepting a bribe is really going to be a matter of serious decision, and the choice will be a free one. If a choice really is a free one, I don't know that there is anything that is such as the choice the person would have made if the person had been put in that situation. So I don't know what we can say about people who would have become Christians. But just at this moment, though, now they're being offered something.
Could I maybe clarify by saying, instead of like would have, saying like that have a propensity towards? Because I think that if you're faced with the creator of the universe and the creator of your own self, and they're giving you this image, I mean, I would think that would be a powerful encounter that would change the mind of someone, like old Aunt Beth that just never heard of it.
Yeah, but suppose you're suddenly shown a picture of yourself that's completely at odds with the picture of yourself. And all your virtues turn out are in this picture of vices. And all the choices that you thought were made for one reason were made for another. And it wasn't a very flattering reason after all. I expect that what's in store for most of us on Judgment Day is a really nasty surprise. Not necessarily a really nasty surprise that we're going to find ourselves in hell, but just a really nasty surprise about what it is we have to do to avoid it. You have to accept that a lot of our opinions of ourselves were illusions. And that can, I think, be the case whether you were a member of some tribe in the beginning where the gospel never reached, or whether you're a member of a modern, maybe you're a member of a modern, maybe you're a modern secular person whose gospel never reached because it was never presented in a form accessible to that person. It doesn't make much difference for the general point.
So I was just wondering, in this scenario, had this fictional Hitler been able to accept this impossible picture of himself, would there have been a chance at salvation in that moment, or what would have happened?
That would have been the moment of salvation.
After death?
Well, if you want to insist, as a matter of theology, that you are damned or saved before you die, then you have to suppose, if you accept this story, that this occurs at the moment of death. See, I said it didn't make any difference for our story when it occurred. But of course, if you have a particular theological position about when the moment of salvation occurs, I can build that into the story. I just sort of left that part vague. But this could happen at the moment of death, couldn't it?
Yeah, I think that...
So I could stretch out subjectively the moment of death as long as he likes.
Yeah. I think that I can imagine the judgment happening.
The judgment happening before makes a lot of sense. Or, sorry, the judgment happening after death makes a lot of sense. It's the... moment of salvation happening after death.
So you're thinking of the judgment as a recognition of something that's already happened,
rather than,
and I'm thinking of judgment as the what the person is on trial and his guilt or innocence is being established, rather than the recognition afterwards that it was one thing or the other. But I don't think it makes much difference which way we use the word judgment. So let's say for your purposes, then let's say that all this happens at the moment of death.
Yeah, but then I would still say if he didn't accept the salvation before death.
Well, let's say it occurs a thousandth of a second before he dies. Would that be all right for you?
Sure.
Okay. I mean, that's just a different, slightly different version of the story. I don't have any particular theological beliefs about exactly when the moment the sheep are separated from the goats occurs. That is, you know, in the Narnia book, The Last Battle, you have this picture of this horde of all the creatures in the world running for a gate, and at one point they separate into two streams. Mm-hmm. And the sheep on one side and the goats on the other, so to speak. Where that exact moment of separation is, but it has something to do with death. That's quite clear. And are there perfected saints in this life? Well, some people say, yes, you're saved from the moment you have a certain kind of experience. Other people say, no, you never lose your free will. You always could throw it all away, no matter what you have. Although after death, after you've seen God, you no longer be able. That is, those who have actually experienced the fruits of salvation would no longer be able to throw it away. Then you would be able to put your hand onto a hot stove, because you know what would happen if you did that. But people in this life find bright, shining things offered in this life, sometimes in real competition with the promise of salvation. So, is that help?
Yeah, thank you so much.
So, if I understood you correctly, you contrasted universalism primarily with the other two positions. And I wanted to suggest a way that your position seems to be, at very minimum, purely consistent with universalism, and then use that to ask a question about what you think about the nature of humanity prior to death. So it seems like your position is perfectly consistent with universalism, with the exception that you think that universalism is just really, really, really unlikely. That in the face of pure, divinely clarified truth, even in that case, we would turn away from the truth in all likelihood. But the possibility seems to me that in the case of pure, divinely clarified truth, I just lack the voluntary control to do anything other than embrace that truth. And so I'm wondering if you clarified that a little bit. That's probably good.
I'm not sure about divinely clarified truths. So so here's a story. This is a true story, but there's a man who believed he was dead. Not that he was a spirit or something like that, but that he was a corpse. So the doctor said to him, "Do corpses bleed?" "Of course corpses don't bleed." So the doctor nicked him with a scalpel. "Oh, so corpses bleed." So there was given him an indeniable argument that he wasn't a corpse.
it was incapable of touching his illusion. I don't think that the divine clarification is simply going to be shown to him for a moment, that this is the indisputable nature of his character, of his being. And then the divine clarification will be removed, though the memory that it was clear to him will be removed. Now he will be capable of rejecting it. The question is he capable of accepting it? He was forced to accept it for a moment, at least in the sense he might have been both accepted and then rejected it, that people can have inconsistent beliefs. But at least he was forced to see that it was true, which I suppose implies accepting it. And then he's no longer being forced to see that it is true. He now has a choice. It's like a choice of whether, if somebody tells me something, I believe it. So, you know from the Bible, I suppose, that in days when mirrors were very rare, nobody knew what they looked like. Right? Paul says this, right? So then you see yourself in the mirror, for a minute you have the knowledge of what you look like, then you can't recall it afterwards. Whereas I think most of us have seen ourselves in the mirror so much during our lives that we have a fairly clear picture of what we look like. But apparently, unless you're not as good at recognizing your own face as you are recognizing other people's faces, which we do pretty easily for some reason. I don't know what it is. Well, it's like that. You know when you're looking in a mirror, and the ancient person in the ancient world is looking at one of those polished metal specula. He knows what he looks like. Then when it's taken away, then if you ask him, do you look the way that you just saw yourself? And the person says, no, I'm much better looking. But when you're actually looking at it, you can't deny that that's how you look. I guess that's sort of the way I'm thinking about this. The divine clarification just means that it's indisputably shown to you that something is true, but this thing is incompatible with the self-image that you've created over the course of your whole life. I think then that self-image, just like the madman's delusion that he was a corpse, that may be unbreakable by evidence.
Thank you. So you've offered us a just-so story, but as you know, there are just-so stories that you can tell for universalism, and George MacDonald is an interesting one called Lilith, the Bell Satan's Wife, right?
Mm-hmm.
So suppose we grant that you have a good, viable just-so story. Do you have a particular reason to think that your just-so story would be preferable to alternate just-so stories we tell of the universalist variety, or is it enough for you that you have a viable just-so story that fits what you're taking to be the traditional doctrine?
Well, I mean, the idea is that some people find the traditional doctrine implausible. I'm just trying to say it's not as implausible as you think. It's a just-so story, at least. I mean, does the just so story, would it, if it were true, get around some of the objections you have to damnationism? And it shows that it's not necessarily, I'm not trying to prove that damnationism is true, I'm just trying to prove that some of the traditional criticisms don't stick. So this is not so much in favor of damnationism as it is against certain arguments against it. So there's no positive support that the story is supposed to hold. It's sort of like a defense in the problem of evil discussions.
I figured that might help.
Hi,
So I was curious if anyone does have free will in that moment of judgment, because it seems if no one does, then you're looking at a sort of predetermined picture. But if anyone does at all, then you have to deal with the issue of trying to find a line of who does and who doesn't. And that seems very difficult, especially considering we are all to some point self-deluded.
Well, one of the questions I asked was, would Hitler be given a second chance? And I said, well, not if God knows that he wouldn't, he would do the same thing the second time. So here's just an elaboration of the model. Somebody has free will but rejects his child, though he could have accepted it. Maybe God gives him somehow another chance. Suppose he rejects it a second time, but God knows that he still was able to accept it. I think this will go on until, well, look, if you try, what happens if you lie yourself out of a way in a difficult situation enough? I think what happens is you become unable to tell the truth in a difficult situation. You're making yourself into that kind of person. By a series of free acts, you can make yourself into an unfree person. I think that the person exercises his free will by making the negative decision enough, he'll become unable. He's in fact reinforcing the illusion. But there's no reason, if a person genuinely did have free will in this circumstance, that he shouldn't be given another chance.
I just had a quick related follow-up question. Just to clarify, so is it part of your story then that God is not even capable of giving that divine clarification indefinitely again and again and again, given the state of it?
No, I mean, suppose he gives the divine clarification, the patient is capable of both accepting it and rejecting it, rejects it. It's given, or a similar one is given the second time, he rejects that. God keeps it up. This is a possible elaboration of the story. This story is open-ended. It's like an accordion. You can expand it, you know, you can do stuff into it, depending on what features people find troubling. God will keep it up until the person just becomes inevitably a rejecter.
Right, and so then there would be a point after which God would not be able to do it again.
Well, he would be able to do it again, but if he knows it would have the same result, so what would be the point?
So this seems to me to be about also our relationship with truth, and how we respond to truth in this life really is a picture of how we'll respond to truth in the afterlife. And it seems to me that what I hear you saying, what would be interesting for me to think about would be, I think we're also kind of, I'm sort of wrestling with congruency, and that perhaps there will be a way in which we will continue to be engaged towards more congruency with truth, truth being the spirit of truth, truth being the person Christ, and that on judgment day, what seems to me to be the case, that whatever our relationship to truth has been up to that point, there's probably, here's my question. Is it possible that as I have said yes to the truth, I might not hear, well done, thou good and faithful servant. I might hear a version of that also might say, but this is the picture that is still incomplete about you, and you need to accept this in order for reconciliation to be a part of heaven for you fully, or in an increasing fashion. Does that make sense?
Well, there are some delicate theological points here. I don't want to tread any toes. There are some people that say the tree lies where it falls. You're either blown to death or you're saved or damned. And
there are not disputing that.
Yeah, but well, I bet that some people do dispute that in the sense that. So I'm an Episcopalian. We pray for the dead in our list of prayers. If you say those who say the tree of life was blessed or false, we reject that. Because the saved don't need our prayers because they're in a state of perfect bliss, and the damned are beyond any help. So there's no point in praying for the dead. To pray for the dead is essentially to believe in purgatory. That is, that there is a state of very severe purgation that we have to go, that most people have to go through after their death. That would be part of my picture, but I hesitate to use any to put into my story anything that isn't mere Christianity. That, I think, is mere Catholic Christianity, but it probably isn't mere Protestant Christianity.
Thank you for that.
I had a question a bit beyond the scope of just your particular view that you presented about how your materialist perception of human beings allows for your imaginative picture of hell that you just presented.
Have you asked the question yet?
Yeah, that was my question. I'm sorry.
Oh, that is how the...
How your, yeah, your materialist perception...
Well, so let's look at what the Athanasian Creed says. All men shall rise again with their bodies. Sorry, all human beings to rise. Actually, the Latin word is... and all human beings shall rise again with their bodies, and then they will be judged. So, what's the problem? Were their bodily presence being judged?
What about people who their bodies have been completely destroyed?
So, according to 1 Corinthians 15. There isn't a complete destruction. There's a gymnos kathos, a bare kernel that God keeps and will clothe again with festal flesh. This is what is so the spiritual body lives a, or so the natural body lives a seed, and the seed is the bare kernel, and it is raised again by being clothed with festal flesh. So there is some kind of material continuity for it as well. And that's, obviously, you would probably agree with the people who, you know, some people have themselves frozen so that they can be resuscitated later when they both figure out what, how to deal with what killed them and also the effects of the freezing, which is probably even worse than rupture of the ice crystals, rupture of the walls of all the cells. That's not going to be easy to undo. But then some people don't want to pay for it to have their whole body frozen, so they just have their heads. So suppose we cut off your head and freeze it and then provide it with a new biological that we can undo all these effects. You think that would be you?
No.
Really?
No.
Suppose we cut off your finger and give you a new finger.
Then that would be me.
Arm.
That would be
all your limbs.
That would be me. Wait, I have a question. If you cut off my head, does my head maintain some sort of like, am I aware?
Well, of course, let's suppose the fact that this is done by the scientifically advanced Martians and you never even notice that his machinery is supplied that provides blood with the right pressure and everything. You don't even notice that your body has been cut off.
Oh, then I was the addict.
Yeah, because your thought continues uninterrupted. There's been people who were beheaded in the French Revolution, sometimes agreed to try to, after they were beheaded, to blink their eyes three times. And that was sometimes observed. There can be just a small part of you that survives, but which is sufficient for you. Paul says it's an even smaller part than you might think that God can manage. I don't know what that would be, but I'll take it that there is, we've got omnipotence as some way of doing it. But it's consistent with materialism.
Yeah, thank you for your clarification.
First of all, thanks for giving the talk. It's a lot of stuff I never thought about. Just for clarification's sake, when you were talking about the resuscitation of the damned and how they were not partaking in like the Zoe life, but the Theos, when you say that, is it more about the character of life rather than the duration? Because it seems like for them to part. Okay. So, but if it's because the notion was arguing with the premise of the only access to eternal life was through, I guess, or that eternal life is the only way for humans to live forever, and so that seems to run contrary to that kind of life, I guess. And so I was confused about
getting it.
Yeah, sorry.
Across the antecedents of things like that kind of
right. I guess the question would be, when speaking about the resuscitation of the damned, the first thing I was confused about was, is that on Earth or in Hell that they were being resuscitated?
I don't know that Hell is the name of a place.
Okay. And then I guess the question for me was...
maybe it's not so.
The question was just mainly about, I guess just clarifying what exactly bios is, because I'm unfamiliar.
That's your alive, right?
Right.
That's your bios.
So
you have bios right now.
So the damned would have the same kind of life that I have right now?
That is the damned, as far as the, think of the story of the widow's son in First Kings, or the other widow's son. Testament or Lazarus is the most famous example. Somebody's just restored to the life he had before. Lazarus was not raised to eternal life, right? Somebody said he's the most unfortunate of all men because he had died twice. And he just got back what he had before. Whereas the picture of the Jesus, of the resurrection that most people have is being raised into a new kind of life. We no longer have a natural body, we have a spiritual body. What does that mean? Well, it doesn't mean an immaterial body, but a spiritual body is a contradiction of terms. St. Augustine says, well, a carnal soul means a soul that is subject to the demands of the flesh. It doesn't mean a soul that's made of flesh, right? And similarly, a spiritual body doesn't mean a body that is a spirit, it means a body that is perfectly informed by the spirit. You might say the new kind of life is your body working the way it should. It's the substrate, maybe the biological substrate of the beatific vision. it's the way our unfallen ancestors lived.
Okay, thank you. That was really helpful.
Okay, so you described the chief end being to enjoy God forever, which I would say is mostly agreed with the Christian community. And through annihilation and damnation, you said that some people lose that end of being. And in your imaginative story of hell using Hitler, he rejects that. So he loses his end of being there. So he's not enjoying God forever. And through some of the questions, people were saying, well, what if God gives him the chance again? And he rejects it again. Hitler rejects it. You said, God would hypothetically say, what's the point of me continuing to offer him kind of the chief end of me? So by that, God would be rejecting the chief end of me of enjoying him forever, and damnation would be the exclusion of enjoying God forever. So do you think that by ending that chief end of me, or putting a stop to it, it's on behalf of Hitler, or do you think it's on, or the hypothetical Hitler person, do you think it's on behalf of him rejecting it, or do you think it's on behalf of God, the God of grace, who would probably extend salvation to someone?
Well, I think God will keep offering the choice unless he knows the person isn't capable of accepting it. If Hitler doesn't get a second chance, if fictional Hitler doesn't get a second chance, it's only because God knows that he wouldn't take it. Mm-hmm. That is, it's now, he's now not able to take it.
Right, so God would exclude him then?
He doesn't have to exclude him. He's already excluded. He's excluded himself. But as I say, there's always, whenever you perform a free act, the distinction, you do it all right, but God is present at every moment in that action, providing you with the power to go on and do it. You couldn't, if an atheist says proudly, God does not exist, his mind would not hold together from the beginning to the end of that sentence if God were not continually conferring him on the power of rational thought. So God is involved in all our actions. But insofar as you can make the distinction between what you do and what God does with you, it would be the damned person who is doing the excluded. That is, it's with his will, but against God's will. I don't know. Did I successfully answer this? Did I really answer the question you asked, or did I go off on some tangent?
No, I think you answered the question. It's just me trying to wrap my head around God being able to fully reject someone that's damned.
Well, as I say, does he reject? Who does the rejecting?
The damned does the rejecting, yeah. But...
remember, God continues to love the person. God desireth not the death of the sinner. Right? It's always against his will that this happens, never with his will. And yet it can be true in a sense that it is God who casts him to hell. But the person forces, as a way, forces his hand.
Right, but when you said, there was a question over here in this area, I don't remember what it was. You said God would pretty much say, what's the point of me continuing to extend that?
Well, it would if he knows the choice the person would make, and he's already made it, and he knows it would be the same. If he offered it the second time, he would do the same thing. If he offered it the third time, he would do the same thing twice. If he offered it the fourth time, he'd do the same thing three more times. If it comes to that, then what's the point?
Right.
That is, there's only a point of answering it, of offering the choice, if the person is able to do both sides of the choice.
Go ahead.
Yeah, this is more of a comment than a question. I think the biblical picture in Exodus of both Pharaoh hardening his heart and God hardening Pharaoh's heart makes the point that I think I've heard throughout your lecture that from one viewpoint it could be viewed as God casting the person into hell, and from another viewpoint it could be viewed as the person freely rejecting God, or another way of saying it would be God's permissive will versus God's active will.
The permissive will versus the active will is a, this is some technical terms from theology, but I think they are opposite here. Not everybody will know what they mean.
That's why I used the Exodus one as an example, because there's several occasions where it says Pharaoh hardened his heart, and several occasions where it said God hardened Pharaoh's heart.
And it's as if the writer wasn't seeing any difference.
Exactly.
Indifferently, we can say. Now, I have to admit that this Pharaoh is kind of a special case, because this is an action when God has a purpose he's working out in salvation history, and Pharaoh is an instrument. This is not done for either for the benefit of Pharaoh or in order to condemn him, but simply because God needs certain things to happen. So it doesn't have anything to do with the salvation history of Pharaoh, who, after all, is a child of God and is loved by God as much as Moses was.
Right. Yes, but it does have to do with Pharaoh's choice.
But I don't think that the choice of that I'm ascribing to the person at the moment of damnation is like that. I don't think in that case it's something Pharaoh did all right. Do you think it's something he freely did? Do you think he was unable? Do you think he was able not to harden his heart and say, yeah, go ahead, you guys, go ahead and leave? I don't think he was able to do that. God was causing him, in fact, to behave in a certain way. I don't think that that's what happens when a free choice is made. This is controversial. Thomas Aquinas thought God wanted Eve freely to eat the apple, or let's suppose at any rate God wanted that, so all God had to do was say, let it be the case that Eve freely eats the apple, and she freely eats the apple. God just brings that about. Boy, was there a big fight about this between the Dominicans and the Jesuits in the 17th century. And it's, you know, free will. You know, remember the movie Devil's Advocate? But the devil in it has the wonderful line, free will, yeah, that one's a bitch. It's always difficult when